So my name is Terry. I do a lot of open source Python work, mostly working around cryptography. So this talk is just a hobby project of mine. So I don't have any real training or experience in this area before I decided to start this project. So I'm currently serving national service now. So yeah. Okay, so welcome to my talk, Writing Interpreters for Fun and Profit. I'm sure that all of us know what an interpreter is. Seeing as we are at PyCon, I'm sure that most of us have used the CPython interpreter at one point or another. So why do we want to learn how to write an interpreter? I'm sure that it's not something that most of us will be doing in our day-to-day jobs. We are most likely web developers or data scientists or something similar. So why learn how to write an interpreter? It's a very good learning experience. It's very interesting to gain an understanding of how the tools that we use on a day-to-day basis, how it works, and most of all, because it's a very fun project. So I hope after this talk, more of you will be interested in looking at this topic and maybe writing your own toy interpreters for fun. So what do you think of when you think of interpreters? You might think that they are black magic. You might think that they are very complicated pieces of software. If you look at the CPython source code, source base, that might be true. The CPython source is about a few hundred thousand lines of C code and Python code. However, it's very easy. It's not difficult to write a simple, very simple basic interpreter. You might think that interpreters are mostly written in C or C++ or some other low-level language because they have to be fast. Our goal here today is to write an interpreter in Python without any prior knowledge. So this talk will cover all the basics of how to get a simple interpreter running from scratch. So before we write an interpreter, we'll first need a programming language. So meet Rila. Rila is a toy language that is very simple. Rila has only a few different components. Rila can add integers together and can print out integers to screen. So there's no things like, there's no classes, there's no methods. There's not even floating point support because implementing floating point is quite complex and we want to keep this simple. So our toolbox for today consists of two items, RPython and RPy. What is RPython? RPython is a restricted subset of Python with all the dynamic bits removed from the language. So there's no monkey patching, there's no reflection that you can do, which makes it very easy to statically analyze. RPython is also a framework for producing implementations of dynamic languages. So as a framework, it comes with many useful tools that will help you in writing an interpreter. For example, it comes with JIT compilers and garbage collectors that you can easily integrate into your interpreters. RPython was developed by the PyPy project. I'm sure that many of you have heard of the PyPy project. It's a JIT compiled interpreter for Python that is many times faster than the traditional CPython interpreter. So what RPython does is that it can take some Python code that you have written, it can analyze it, and it will compile it into a standalone binary. So once this, once your interpreter is compiled, there will be no dependencies on the Python interpreter, although you've written the interpreter in Python. So what is RPy? RPy is a lexer and parser generator that works with RPython. If you're not very sure what the terms lexing and parsing means, don't worry, we'll cover that shortly. So here, these are the two items that we'll be using. So let's get started. What is an interpreter traditionally made of? Most interpreters consist of five components: a lexer, a parser, an abstract syntax tree, or AST for short, a bytecode compiler, as well as a bytecode interpreter. While some interpreters might leave out one or two of these components, for example, some interpreters might choose to execute the AST directly instead of compiling it to bytecode, most interpreters are made up of these five components. So what is lexing? Lexing is converting a sequence of characters into a sequence of tokens. So you'll be turning, lexing turns your source code, which is print 1 plus 1 semicolon, it turns it into a stream of tokens. So how do we write a lexer in Python? Like I mentioned earlier, RPy is a lexer generator, which is one of the few ways of writing a lexer. So with RPy, you import the lexer generator class, you instantiate the object, and you can add some rules. So RPy takes rules in the form of regular expressions. So you can see that our lexer has four tokens that it recognizes: a number token, an add token, a semicolon token as well as a print token. So you can add as many tokens as you want as long as they don't clash. You can also tell the lexer to ignore certain characters. For example, we'll be ignoring white space because white space is not significant, unlike in Python. Once you're done adding your rules to your lexer generator, you can call the build method on the lexer generator, which produces a lexer object. So once you have this lexer object, how do you lex your source code? The lexer object contains a single method, lex, which takes in source code in the form of a Python string. So passing in this source code into the lex method produces an iterator. Iterating over this iterator produces your token objects one by one in sequence. So that's it for the lexer. Once you have the lexer, the next step is to write a parser. So what is parsing? Parsing is basically turning your stream of tokens that you obtain from your lexing stage into an abstract syntax tree, or AST, which is a tree representation of your source code, a nested tree representation of your source code. So this is the AST that we want to achieve from our stream of tokens. So before we begin writing our parser, we'll first need to define our AST. So each node in the AST can be defined as a Python class that inherits from a base class node. Each node requires different arguments to instantiate, so we have different init methods for each node. So as you can see, the block node is made up of several statement nodes, so it takes a statements parameter. While the statement node consists of an expression, the number node contains a value, the binary op node, for example, which is your addition, contains the left and right operator, the left and right number, as well as the operator. So once you have this AST defined, the next step is to write your parser. So RPy is in addition to being a lexer generator, it's also a parser generator, which is one of the few ways of writing a parser. Rules in parsers are generally called productions. So to define your productions, you can use the decorator dot production. The productions in RPy take a very specific format. It's the item, followed by a colon, followed by what the item is made of. Once you have this, and in addition to this production, you also need to define what action is taken when this thing is encountered. So you can see from the first production that our statements item is made up of statements followed by a statement. If this is encountered, we want to return a block node, our AST block node. So you can see that the function takes a S parameter. What is this S? This S is a list of all the items found on the right side of the production. So it's a list. S0, the first item in the list, is statements in the production rule, while S1 is statement. You can also see that the second production rule states that statements can also be a statement. So statements can also consist of a single statement. So when this happens, we also return a block with a single statement in it. So what's a statement? A statement is an expression followed by a semicolon token. So when this happens, we return a statement, the statement node, with the expression in it. So here are some other productions. A statement can also be a print token followed by an expression followed by a semicolon. So when we encounter this, we want to return our print AST node. So what's an expression? An expression can be a number token. So when we encounter this, we return our number AST node that contains the number. An expression can also be an expression followed by an add token followed by an expression. So when we encounter this, we return our binary op AST node. So like I mentioned, Rela only supports addition, but binary op can also support things like subtraction, multiplication, equality checks, anything that compares two items. So once we have defined our production rules, we can call the build method on the parser generator, which produces a parser object. Like the lexer object previously, this parser object contains a single method pass, which expects a stream of tokens, which is of course produced by our lexer. So once we call the pass method, it returns our AST. So once we have our AST, the next step is bytecode compilation, turning our AST into Python bytecode. I mean not Python, Rela bytecode. So our relay interpreter supports four different bytecodes: the loadcons bytecode, binary add, pop top, as well as print. So each bytecode does different things. So each AST will compile into each node in the AST will compile into different bytecodes. So before we write our bytecode in bytecode compiler, we'll need a few other items. The first class that we need to define is the context class. This context class is where you store the bytecode as we are going through the AST and building it up. So as you can see, this context class has a new cons method, which initializes a new constant. It also has an init method, which appends a bytecode onto our context. Once we are done building up our context, compiling our AST into our bytecode, we can call the create bytecode method, which returns a bytecode object. This bytecode object is a static representation of your bytecode. It's very similar to the context object, except that you cannot modify it. So this bytecode object is something that you can serialize to a file, in which case you can pass the file into the interpreter if you support it, and it will behave very similar to the .pyc files that the Python interpreter supports. So doing this allows you to skip the parsing and lexing, as well as the bytecode compilation stage of running your code. So the next thing that we'll need is our object model. Relay only supports numbers, so our object model is very simple. It has a single relay number class that inherits from a base relay object class. So the relay number supports a few different operations. It supports addition, so you can add it to another relay number class. It also supports printing a string representation of it, so it has a string method as well. So once we have done this, we can begin writing our bytecode compiler. So our bytecode compiler takes the form of compile methods on each of our AST node. So different AST nodes produces different bytecodes. So the block node goes through all the statements contained within the block node and compiles the statements. The statement node compiles the expression that it contains. As well as emits a pop-top bytecode. The number node adds a load cons bytecode and stores the constant into the context object. The binary op node compiles the left and right expression, as well as append the bytecode binary add onto the context. The print node does a very similar thing. It compiles the expression and emits the print bytecode. So once you have defined the compile methods for each of our AST node, we can go ahead and call .compile on our AST. So this recursively goes through your AST, because your block might contain several statements. So you might have several blocks in your source code. It goes through them all and compile it into bytecode. So our bytecode compiler will turn our AST, which is this, into a list of bytecodes. So we compile four different bytecodes from our source code, two load cons, a binary, as well as a print. So this is the bytecode representation of our source code. The final step is to write our bytecode interpreter. Before we write our bytecode interpreter, we'll first need to define a frame object. So this frame object is a stack where you can push and pop items from it. This is where you will store all the intermediate values that your interpreter produces as it iterates over your bytecode and executes it. So our interpreter itself contains a method interpret. It takes a bytecode as well as a frame object. It iterates over the bytecode and compiles it. And executes it. So our interpreter supports bytecodes. Each bytecode that it supports will have an individual method on the interpreter. So for example, the load cons bytecode will push a constant onto the frame and returns. Our binary add bytecode will pop the two items from the frame, adds them together, and pushes the results onto the frame. Our pop top method pops the top item from the frame. our print method pops the top item from the frame and returns the string representation of it. So that might be a little bit confusing, so I have a diagram of how it works as our interpreter goes through our bytecode and executes it. So the first bytecode is load cons, which pushes a VLAN number object onto the frame. Our second bytecode is also load cons, which pushes another number onto the frame. The next bytecode, binary add, pops the first VLAN number off the frame, pops the second number off the frame, adds them together, which produces a new VLAN number object containing 2. And after that, it pushes it onto the frame. So the next bytecode is print. Print pops the value off the frame, calls the string method on the object, which returns the string representation of the object, and prints that out onto the screen. So this is basically how our interpreter will work as it goes through our bytecode. It reads each bytecode one by one, executes it, and pushes and pops intermediate values on and off the frame. So putting it all together, like I mentioned before, R Python compiles Python code into a C binary, an executable. So to do that, you need to define 3 functions, a run function, an entry point function, and a target function. So the entry point function takes a parameter, which is it's a list of arguments that you pass into your interpreter. So in this case, we will want to pass a source file into our interpreter. If we do not pass a source file, we want to raise an error message which states missing argument. If a source file is passed into the interpreter, we will pass the file name into the run function, which reads the source code of the file. It initializes a context. It lexes and passes the source code into an AST. It compiles it into bytecode. It initializes the frame, initializes the interpreter, and calls the interpret. It calls the interpret method to run your bytecode. So in general, this is how you write a very simple interpreter in the R Python framework. Adding support for more stuff is a matter of adding the correct lexer rules, adding the correct parser productions, defining the appropriate bytecodes for it. For example, iteration requires new bytecodes like jump. While subtraction, you might have a binary subtract bytecode, for example. So I have a demo of the project. What I have here so far is the Rela interpreter that I've written. As you can see, it's not a very large project. It's about 300 or so lines of, oops. Yes, it's about 300 or so lines of Python code. So it's definitely a very small project. I have a makefile here which calls the R Python interpreter and tells it to compile the main method of the main.py of my project. So R Python can compile an unoptimized build, which is the first target. So I do not do any JIT interpretation. I do not add any garbage collection into the project, into the interpreter. So building this takes about 15 seconds to 1 minute, while an optimized build with a JIT interpreter, advanced garbage collection and all that stuff, takes about 15 to 30 minutes to compile depending on your laptop. So this timing is for this very simple 300 line interpreter. So a large production-ready interpreter like the PyPy project will take many hours to compile, as well as requiring a lot of memory. So I'll call make to compile my interpreter now. So you can see it scans our source code. It tries to analyze it because this R Python subset is not dynamic. It can be statically analyzed. It will try to produce some C code from it. You produce some C code from it, as well as compile the whole thing. So this whole process takes about 13 seconds here. It might take maybe 20, 45 seconds on a slower laptop. It produces a single binary in our target folder. Yes, it produces a single binary. You can see that it's an executable file, so it's not Python. It does not depend on the Python interpreter. It's only dynamically linked to some standard system libraries found on GCC. Found on OS X. So these are some of the OS X libraries that all Mac executables were linked to. So I have this 300-line interpreter is slightly more advanced than the one I've shown in the slides, because it also supports subtraction, multiplication, division, comparisons, equality checks, and Boolean values. So I have an example file here. You can see that it has several. It will do several different things. It will add, it will subtract, it will multiply, it will divide. It will try to compare it against another number. It also has shebang support, so that's pretty interesting. Oops. So I can call the binary that we have produced. If I don't pass in a source file, it asks me to specify a source file. So when I specify the source file that I've written, it will print out some values. So you might notice that 10 divided by 3 produces the value 3 here, because floating point is not supported, so it will round off the number. I can also execute the file directly because it has a shebang line on top of it. So you'll look on my path and find the closest interpreter. So you'll do the same thing. So this is a demo of the code that I've written so far. So back to the slides. How do we go about optimizing our interpreter? So this interpreter is very, very basic. It has no loops, it has no conditionals, it has no support for classes or functions or even modules. So speed is not a concern at the moment. However, once we have added all of this into our interpreter, how do we make it fast? RPython itself is a framework that comes with support for easily integrating JIT compilers as well as garbage collection into our project. So how you do this is it provides several functions which you can use in your interpreter. It takes a little bit of work to get it integrated. However, it's a lot simpler than writing your own JIT interpreters and garbage collection from scratch. And this JIT interpreter and garbage collection that you can get from the framework is the same one that the PyPy project is using in production currently. And if you've seen the benchmarks, you all know that the PyPy project is, in general, at least 2 or 3 times faster than the CPython interpreter. So using this framework, you can get very advanced JIT compilers and garbage collection easily integrated into your interpreter, which saves you the work of actually implementing it yourself. Are there any interpreters besides the PyPy project that are currently using RPython? There's a few I know of. Which are currently in various stages of implementation. So they, besides RPython, most of them do not support the full breadth of the languages. There's an interpreter called Topaz, which is a Ruby interpreter, written in this fashion. It's written by Alex Gaynor. If I'm not wrong, it supports most of the basic Ruby. However, there's a little bit of work that needs to be done to get it working with all the modules that are currently written in Ruby. There's also an interpreter called HippyVM, which is a RPython interpreter for PHP. I've seen the latest benchmarks. It's almost as fast as the PHP interpreter that Facebook has produced. I can't remember what the thing is called currently. But it's very impressive because that... HipHop, yes. So HippyVM is almost as fast as HipHop, But it's, from what I know, it's a team of less than 5 people working on the VM. So it's quite impressive that you can write something that is as fast as hip-hop, which Facebook has invested a lot of effort into it. So I'm using this framework. So I have the Python source on GitHub. The talk is a little bit fast. I did not expect. I thought I could speak for longer, but yeah, it's done. If you're interested, the documentation is to obtain this R Python 2 chain, you have to clone the PyPy project from its Bitbucket account. So you currently cannot install R Python from PyPI, for example. Yes, thank you. Any questions? Yeah.
The talk was named writing in terms of profit.
Unfortunately, it will be pretty difficult to make a profit from this, because I'm not sure if you have visited the PyPy project page recently. It's constantly asking for donations to actually support their effort in writing the PyPy interpreter. So even for a project that's as large as PyPy, it has trouble getting sufficient funds to get developers to work on it. So it's very unlikely that writing interpreters can gain you any profit. Unless maybe you're in academia and doing it for like research or something. All right, no other questions?
So if there's no more, then this is the end of Mr. Talk.